So children, we are going to discuss about the next topic, that is gas transport. Okay, we have done the gas exchange topic in three parts. Now we will discuss about gas transport. So children, let me show you this flow chart. There are two types of respiratory gases we know. One is the oxygen and the other one is carbon dioxide. And both of them need to be transported now. So transport of gases, first we will see oxygen transport. It is always from lungs to the tissues. Always alveoli, which are rich in lungs, will transfer the oxygen to the tissues. And this is done in two ways. The first one is in physical solution called blood plasma. Now, why do we call physical solution? Because here a physical thing is present. Physically, the solution is present, and that solution is called plasma. We all know that blood is made up of two components. One is liquid and the other one is solid. And the liquid component of blood is called plasma. So the first way of transportation of oxygen is through blood plasma, and the second method of transportation of oxygen is through hemoglobin, which will form a compound called oxyhemoglobin. This was about the oxygen transport. Next, let's move on to carbon dioxide transport. It is done from tissues towards the lungs, and it has three methods. One is it can be transported as carbonic acid. Another one, it can also be transported as carbaminohemoglobin, again a compound which will be formed with the hemoglobin. And the third method of transport is as bicarbonates. So any of the three methods will be used for the transportation of carbon dioxide. Now let's see each one of them in detail. So first is oxygen transport. We all have just now studied that oxygen transport is done in two methods. One is the physical solution, and then the other one is the oxyhemoglobin. And I just told you that plasma is the liquid part of the blood. Children, this type of transportation is only 3%. This type of transportation is only 3%. That is, 3% of oxygen is carried by dissolving in plasma. Very little amount of oxygen is transported in this manner. Rest 97% of oxygen is transported as oxyhemoglobin by the help of hemoglobin, which is a red colored pigment present in the RBCs or red blood cells of the blood. Now children, as you see hemoglobin, the word hemoglobin, the first part is called heme, where heme means iron. So hemoglobin is a pigment which contains iron in its chemical formula. Okay, and red blood cells, as you see here in the figure, are biconcave. Now what do you mean by concave? They are concave from both the sides. From here also it is concave, from here also it is concave. So that means it's a spherical shape, and we all know that the surface area of sphere is the largest. So why this question can be asked, that why do RBCs have spherical shape? Reason is, more the surface area, more of the oxygen can be absorbed by the hemoglobin. So oxygen from the lungs will combine with the hemoglobin, that is HP molecules, and this bound oxygen will be used up, and later on it will be given to the tissues. Carried by the blood, it will be given to the tissues. Children, this is the structure of hemoglobin. In this year, in class 11th, you are not supposed to go deep into this structure. We will do it later on in class 12. Right? So, let's see the second method of transport as oxyhemoglobin. Oxygen binds with the hemoglobin in a reversible manner to form oxyhemoglobin. Now, whenever oxygen combines with hemoglobin, a reversible, now mind this word children, reversible means again they can bind and they can also be broken back into the reactants. This is what I want to say, that is, this is quite unstable. If hemoglobin is combined with oxygen to form oxyhemoglobin, again this oxyhemoglobin can be broken back into oxygen and hemoglobin. So it is quite unstable, or you can also say it is reversible. Oxygen binds with hemoglobin in a reversible manner to form oxyhemoglobin. This is called oxygenation. Why? Because oxygen has been added. One more thing children, hemoglobin has four heme units. As you see, 1, 2, 3, 4, the heme units have been provided. The blue portions you see here, heme units, there are four heme units. So each hemoglobin molecule, because you can just say that there are four chairs, these heme units are chairs, and each of the hemoglobin molecule can carry four oxygen molecules. That means one oxygen can settle down on these heme units or these chairs. So that means one hemoglobin molecule will carry four oxygen molecules. So one hemoglobin, you see, one hemoglobin combines with four oxygen, okay, and these are the conditions which will be required. What will be the conditions for combination? The partial pressure of course should be high, and the partial pressure of carbon dioxide should be low. So in this condition, four oxygen molecules will attach to the one hemoglobin molecule to form oxyhemoglobin. So heme units, they have one of the heme unit, they have shown you here. You see, this is one of the heme unit has been elaborated here, or they have increased the size of the heme unit. You see here, iron is present, this is heme, and this is all over known as the heme unit. So this is how oxyhemoglobin will combine. Now binding of oxygen depends upon PO2 and PCO2, I just told you. When I showed you this equation, I told you that the conditions should be that the partial pressure of oxygen should be high and partial pressure of carbon dioxide should be low. So along with that, another thing which should be taken care of is hydrogen ion concentration, that is pH, and temperature. So all in all, four things are responsible for the combination of hemoglobin for oxygen. And what are those four things? Partial pressure of oxygen, partial pressure of carbon dioxide, hydrogen ion concentration or pH, and temperature. Now in the alveoli, we all know that alveoli are the part where the partial pressure of oxygen is high because the inhalation is done, and during inhalation partial pressure of oxygen is high and the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is low, and also hydrogen ion concentration is less and the temperature is also low. So all these factors favor the formation of oxyhemoglobin. If the PO2 is high and other things are low, only one thing is high, partial pressure of oxygen is high, but other things like PCO2, hydrogen ion concentration and temperature, all three of them are low, this circumstance is favorable for the formation of oxyhemoglobin. So oxyhemoglobin will be formed, right? Now in tissues, what will happen? That was the case of alveoli. Now let's see what will happen in the tissues. The circumstances are totally opposite. PO2 is low, whereas PCO2, H plus ion concentration and temperature are high. So what will happen? Oxyhemoglobin will dissociate, or this compound will break into oxygen and hemoglobin. So the oxygen will be released. So this will happen in the tissues, and when the oxygen is released, this oxygen is used by the tissues or cells for the various activities. Understood? I hope this is clear. Every 100 ml of oxygenated blood, I hope you understand, every 100 ml of oxygenated blood can deliver around 5 ml of oxygen to the tissues under normal physiological conditions. That means if the person is healthy, fit, and no disease is there, then every 100 ml of oxygenated blood will give 5 ml of oxygen to the tissues. This is under the normal physiological conditions. Okay, now comes the oxygen dissociation curve, which is very important. Should I make another video for that? No, only oxygen dissociation curve we can do here in this video. So you see, there is a sigmoid curve shown to you. On the x-axis, they show partial pressure of oxygen, which is measured in millimeter of mercury. And on the y-axis, they show percentage saturation of hemoglobin with oxygen. That means how much oxygen is binded up with the oxygen. Kitna percent hemoglobin saturate ho gaya. So it's a sigmoid curve obtained when percentage saturation of hemoglobin with oxygen is plotted against the PO2. It is used to study the effect of factors like PCO2, hydrogen ion concentration, etc. on the binding of oxygen with the hemoglobin. Now we can see that as the partial pressure is rising, you see, the partial pressure is rising, the saturation of oxygen with the hemoglobin is also rising, but to some extent, then after that stability has been achieved. So if the partial pressure of oxygen is rising, the saturation, that means the binding of oxygen with the hemoglobin, will also rise, but to a certain extent. After that, we will achieve stability. That means partial pressure badh raha hai, but binding jo hai, wo nahi badh rahi hai. Right? So that is why we are getting a sigmoid curve. This is called oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. We will come to know that at which stage and at which, under which circumstances oxygen will dissociate from hemoglobin. So we will understand here that if PCO2 is high, if H plus ion concentration is high, then the possibility is that oxygen will dissociate or will separate from hemoglobin. Right? So this is all about oxygen transport.